Okay. Hi, everyone, and welcome to the session about the measuring DevSecOps and like how to build the metrics to understand effectiveness and the success. Let's start with the presenting myself. I'm Victoria, and I do work for the Microsoft. Physically, I'm located in Oslo, Norway, and I'm mostly focusing on the development, security, identity, and DevOps as a culture, but also the processes and the tools, like for the last I don't know, more than like 10, 14 years. And as for today, we are going to talk about the measuring DevSecOps. And therefore, to get everyone on the same page, we will start with the DevSecOps. So what I want to do is I want to walk through the what is the DevSecOps and where it came from. What is the most common understanding and definition of the DevSecOps? When we will switch gears and we will look on the metrics, why we're so important, so why we all should pay attention and on them and measure. And of course, what exactly we should measure? Should we look on every single step and measure it, or we just need to find a few and the most important ones? And then finally is how should we measure? What is an approach? What should we use not to fail? And I will wrap up with the summarizing the action points, so you can do after the talk some active actions in terms of the measuring your security posture in your development. But let me start with the question. Usually in the live session, I would ask to raise the hands for the proper answer. What is correctly DevOpsSec or DevSecOps? Because I have heard a lot of the definitions like DevOpsSec, DevSecOps, SecDevOps, security in the DevOps. And during these years, all the time I need to battle like, no, you should say DevSecOps or you should say security in the DevOps. I can give you some spoiler alert. Honestly, I don't like almost all of them. Because for the reason that they emphasize security as a separate unit. But okay, let's look on the history, how it all that came. In the beginning, the movement started out being called DevOpsSec, and Sec was appended at the end, like almost as caboose on the train. And originally, that came from the marketing hype, because every security vendor they tried to say like, okay, you are doing the security, so you are doing right now with our tools DevOpsSec. But the thing is that the movement is not about the tools only, right? It's more about the way in which we work in the parallel. And in reality, security must be thought, designed, and practiced through the process. In light of this, the more current term is DevSecOps. One where we wave security inside of our development, inside of our daily communication as in developers. So at the end of the day, the community popularized the DevSecOps concept, and this is how we ended up. But the question is, again, what is exactly is the DevSecOps? I tried to look into the different definitions, and I ended up with the definition provided by the JFrog. And honestly, I find this as the most favorite one. The JFrog states that the DevSecOps is the philosophy of integrating security practices within the DevOps process or security first culture. And if we will narrow it, the DevSecOps is all about introducing security earlier in the lifecycle of the development, who's minimizing vulnerabilities and bringing security closer to the IT and the business objectives. I really like that last quote because it takes the current security in the natural. But the question is again, like, what does it mean in the practice? Let's look on the thing like how do we deliver the application or how we do the development. And obviously we start with the planning, we start with the development, and then we commit the code which triggers our CI pipeline, which does the building and the testing processes, and it lands into our acceptance environment or the dev QA environment where we run different tests, we check with the business that everything is fine, and then we go to the production. And from the production, we switch to the operations mode, where we learn how application acts and live. DevOps also pushes us to learn from that by the collecting the telemetry, right? We learn and we repeat that cycle all the time. Depends of what is like that cycle defined in your team, in your development company. It could be either we deliver every sprint or the release. And this is where the DevOps comes in. I give a talk actually about the DevSecOps practices, and I gave that talk how to implement the security inside of the DevOps last NDC Porto. And if you will get curious, you can just look on the YouTube. I will not deep dive into all the concept, but what I'm going to do, I will anyway go briefly through all the activities, so to be sure that we are on the same page. So, okay. When we speak about integrating the security in the DevOps, we try to integrate it on each of the steps in the development. And then usually we start from the development process where we add that threat modeling, like predicting or planning the threats, and then converting them in kind of the user stories. And this is what the threat modeling is in a nutshell. Then we start to utilize the security plugins for our favorite development environments. And then you also integrate the pre-commit hooks, which can check the code before you have pushed that to your code repository for the most common security violations. Additionally, on the top, what we do, usually we integrate the secure coding standards, like in the same way, like as a team works according to the best practices or the coding standards defined by the team. In the same way, you can integrate some security rules into these coding standards. And the last but not least is always peer review on each of the pull requests. we need to be sure that someone who is more mature, maybe who is like the dev lead, looks on our code and sees that everything is done properly. And at the same stage, we can check that we also following our secure coding standards. And then the code gets pushed into the repository. This is where the static code analysis tools comes into the play, which scans your code for the potential security issues. And this is where also when the build gets triggered, our unit test comes in. And in the same way, if we did the threat modeling, we have included the user stories, or we have included also some test cases around the security, which needs to be tested alongside with the regular tests. And another thing, what is most important, and I guess it's like it is discussed everywhere, that in today's world, the 90% of the development relies on the external libraries, on the external packages from the open source world. And therefore, we need to look on the dependency management. We need to understand that our dependencies are also secure enough. And they don't have, for example, inappropriate license like the GPL, which will enforce you to outsource your code and so on. Okay, so after the CI integration, we came into the acceptance stage. So we have delivered our product solution to the dev environment, QA environment, and this is where you can focus on the infrastructure as a code. Because if you do your infrastructure as a code, you can apply the security checks in the same way as you do with your regular code, like .NET, C Sharp, you name it. And since your application is already built and running, you can do the security scanning, like automated penetration testing. This is what called like the security scanning. This is, again, the stage if you are delivering to the cloud, you can create the checks for the cloud configuration. And of course, in the same way like we do the regular acceptance testing, we can do the acceptance testing with the focus to the security. Finally, we went to the production, and we continue to add the security as in layers, like onion layers. And on the top, we again repeatedly check the configuration, because sometimes, and I have seen these cases, then the development environment is not one-to-one to the production one. And maybe the things what you have added in development for the debugging purposes, like open more relaxed rules, you forgot to remove them and you ended up to have the same ones into the production. Therefore, the configuration checks are quite important too. And when we speak about the penetration testing, even it doesn't fit quite into the DevOps model of the continuous integration, continuous delivery, but sometimes it's worth to postpone to going to the production, especially if you are going with the really important functionality for your business. Then it's maybe worth to hire a third-party company who is going to do the pen test to assure that all your measures, what you have done during the development, are in the place, like, and maybe there are some things what you have forgot or you didn't know simply about them. So the pen test is still alive and it needs to be considered. And finally, we are in operations mode, and this is where we can learn when it comes to the security. We can learn a lot from the DevOps, and in the same way, like the DevOps speaks a lot about the traceability, about the tracing, monitoring. In the same way, you do the continuous monitoring from the security perspective. Like you analyze how your application acts, if there are some potential brute force attacks or any other activities with the goal to compromise your application. Also, what you can do the pen test not only like before going to the production, but also being during the production, like in the background. Last but not least, it's really important to learn the culture about the blameless postmortems. In the same way, like we speak in terms of the DevOps, in the same way, we should speak about the security, that it's really important to grow up the culture inside of the team. But when you're not afraid to admit the mistakes, or if there's something has been forgotten to implement. Because if we live in a fearful environment, we end up not openly discuss the things which came out like wrongly. So the blameless postmortems is really good lesson how to learn not only why the security incident has happened, but also how you reacted on that security incident, and what needs to be done to prepare for the next disaster recovery. All of these sets, all of these actions, they formulate what is called like the DevSecOps or the security in the DevOps. And of course, you may say to me, like, yeah, okay, Victoria, we are doing these practices, or some of them, we do DevSecOps. We are fine, right? We secure, and why the heck we should worry? All is happening. Really? So then the question is, why should you measure at all? Maybe it all works as needed. And let me challenge you. And try to think about the following questions. First of all, how do you know that the security tools that you have implemented in your development lifecycle work at all, and are they efficient enough? Then another thing, what I have seen, like, is the security bottleneck for the delivery speed. The teams that tend to have this practice, like when you introduce the new security check, which may slow down the development or the delivery, and we end up like by switching off, by saying, oh, you know, the security is bottleneck. But is it in reality? How do you know that? And another question is, like, do you know that you progress? I mean, let's imagine that you have the same dependency management scanning tool for the several months, and you are focusing, you're fixing the issues, but do you really know that you progress, that you're not repeating the same mistakes like by not updating the libraries and so on? Another question is, do we prioritize the proper security measures? You have done a lot of the investment, for example, into the SAST tool, like static application security analysis tool, which scans your code for the security reasons. And at the end of the day, maybe that was not the most critical place. Again, maybe those dependencies were the more critical. So how do you know that you have prioritized the proper ones? And finally, is the DevSecOps effective at all? I mean, like we can claim that we are doing the DevSecOps. We can say to our CISO and the management, like, yes, great, we are doing that stuff. And then the next time the CISO is going to ask you, like, okay, when they plan usually the budget, it's like, we have done everything, like, all is done. So it seems you don't need to have another budget for the next year. And that's why the measurements helps make security as priority. And if you can build the KPIs, these KPIs can help you align both security and non-security stakeholders as to where, why, and how security fits into the process. So let me conclude with the sentence that without the appropriate measurement, DevSecOps becomes more than hype than value, right? I hope at this time we have agreed that the DevSecOps is a hype if you don't measure it. We assume that we are secure, but we are not doing anything like so. Okay, the next question is actually what should we measure? And it comes actually to the two main things which defines the scope. The first one is a really important one. You need to define what DevSecOps means to your organization in the same way like you're defining what DevOps means for you. Because the word DevSecOps, like you already have seen in the beginning, can mean different things to the different people. Some can say it's just about the culture, it's about the training, it's about like following some processes. On other hand, the vendors who tries to sell you a lot of the security tools, they can claim that the tooling is what builds security. And then the question comes to the point like, what exactly means DevSecOps in your team? And I would say like this is not something new. This is in the same way like you need to look what is a DevOps for you. Is it more about the people? Is it more about the tooling? Is it more about like the processes? Once you have identified what DevSecOps means for you as a team, for you as an organization, you can scope it, and then you can. Look into the second point, like you need to focus and identify your DevSecOps challenges. Before you figure out which metrics to track, you need to identify what challenges your organization or your team has and what you're trying to solve. So you could put the biggest focus on these specific metrics. And finally, that means like, We shouldn't invent the bicycle because, like, again, I mentioned, if you're doing the DevOps, you already at this point, you realize that the DevSecOps heavily relies on the DevOps. And what you can do, you can look on the DevOps metrics already. Because if you look like on the DevOps, the main goal of the DevOps is all about the velocity, quality, and the performance. And the metrics are built around these three areas. And in the same way, we can look and try to build the metrics also for the security. Like I mentioned, I don't want to invent the bicycle. And there's a real good book, which is called The Science of the DevOps or Accelerate, which talks, I think it has like the few chapters only about how to build the metrics for the DevOps. And let's look into the details and see which of these metrics we can take and align to the security. So let's start with the first one. And the first one states that you need to measure at the global level, not on the team level. Because at the end of the day, the goal of the security is to help the business to achieve its goal. Business doesn't have the security department just because it's fancy or it's required by the regulatory or because it's required by some other reason. The security is supportive, and therefore, we as a security folks or the security awareness people, we need to focus how to help the business to achieve their goal in the secure way. And this is the reason why when you build your measurements or the KPIs, you shouldn't focus on the specific team. You should focus on the organizational level, on the global level. Because let's imagine the situation. You have like the several teams. One team may work on the front end, another can work on the back end. I'm right now simplifying, but let's assume that the backend team is heavily focusing on the security and the front end is like, nope, that's fine. We don't focus on that. And if the security breach happens because of that team on the global level, that means that the business suffers. And also, if you focus on the global level, that helps to avoid the silent thinking. So that helps you to build the DevSecOps culture across all the teams. Because if you have just one team who's focusing on that, that's on silent thinking. Another thing is you need to focus and you need to measure outcomes versus outputs. And that means that, let's take the example. You should measure the hours spent on the security. What matters at the end of the day? If these hours help to reduce the attack surface, it doesn't matter how many hours you have spent for the implementing some security controls, like 4 or 5 hours. If it doesn't give any outcome, it's useless. One more thing is focus on the capabilities, not the maturity. You know, when you start to implement the DevOps, usually you end up focusing on the maturity models. I'm not stating that the maturity models are useless. No, they are really helpful because they can show you what is the state of your progression in terms of implementing the processes and the tools. But the problem with the maturity models are that they tend to focus on the final state. So once it has been implemented, it's done. Through the years, we have learned that the security is not the finite game, right? It's infinite game. It's all the time. It's all about improving the process. So that's why you need to focus on the capabilities. And that means like, how do you progress, how your team is progressing in terms of the education, what are the new capabilities, what you can get from that team over the time. The last thing is what I want to take from this book is really good one. That means that don't miss the forest for the trees. And that also comes from my experience where I was dealing with some customer was really focusing in the team like we are writing our own packages, we are signing these packages, like we are ensured that no one is fixing that. So literally they were focusing on the one individual security component. Meanwhile, they had some big issues in other areas of the development. Because, I mean, if you start to focus too much on the individual security component, you can lose the sight of the impact of other components on the overall system. So these are the four good advices when it comes to the what in overall. And one more big advice from my side is what I always tend to say to my customers and to the teams with whom I work deeply is never ever start with the tools. Don't start with the tools. I used to have my colleague who was saying like tools are made for the fools. But the problem with the tooling is that vendors may give the specific security metrics. If I will just narrow down to the tools which help you to build the security metrics, these tools, they are quite biased. And these metrics are supporting only the things what are built in that particular security tool. at the end of the day, these are not the silver bullet. Because, I mean, as a result, you can buy the tool, you can try to fit it in your culture, into your development, and you can get you can get disappointment. So my advice is never ever start with the shopping, right? Like buying the tool and trying to fit it. Just because Gartner said that this tool is cool, it doesn't mean that that tool is cool specifically for you, for your development. And start with what actually matters to you. And to be able to start with that one, you need to start with the KPI. And the question is like, okay, what is a KPI? It's not a new thing. Business is using that one, DevOps is using that one. And basically the KPI is all about the key performance indicator, which helps us to measure the success or failure of the business goal, function, or objective to provide actionable information on which decisions can be based. But the most important is that each KPI must have a meaning, because you can't just write down, let's measure that thing, without digging in if that is meaningful for you. So where do we start when it comes to the KPI? Where I can find the help for the identifying the security KPIs? Again, that's not something new. When you start to deal with the KPIs, there is the thing what is called SMART. And the SMART objectives or the goals are actually wonderful things, because they bring clarity, structure, measurability, and SMART stands for the simple. So when you think about your KPI, it should not be complicated to measure. It should have the clear purpose, then measurable. So this is the place where you need to decide what type of the KPIs should be. Should you base your measurements on the quantity or on the quality? Because once you have defined it, once you have decided that you go for the qualitative approach, you should stay consistent. And then actionable, these KPIs should be used as a driver for the decision. You shouldn't measure something what doesn't give you the action point. Like, let's take the example. I want to measure that how many times, like what are the top three vulnerabilities we see constantly. And that is actionable, because I mean, if I will spot on these top three, I can create the action which allows me to address that issue. Why developers constantly keep getting back to that security problem? And again, it should obviously be relevant, right? And in terms of in our case, it should be relevant to the security. The last is all about the time-based. The KPIs can and should be used to show the changes over the time, like how do you progress. Another thing, don't get trapped. It's a common misconception that KPIs needs to be smart to be effective. Yeah, in fact, there's no thing such as smart KPIs. It's your objectives or the goals which needs to be smart, like way around. Simple and effective, like. And like I said, there's no silver bullet all the time. I can't give you the recipe which you can take and just implement it, because the smart KPIs, they would be different for each organization. It's simply not possible to create a one-size kit which fits for the all companies. So and remember that the KPI is a metric or indicator that tells you whenever you are on the track to achieve that goal. So another question is, okay, how many KPIs do I need in reality? The good advice for you, if when you start to think what should be measured and how many KPIs, there you need to think about these following questions, like. The first one, will the KPI provide value to a wide variety of the groups or users, or just for the few individuals? Remember that what the reference back to the Accelerate book. Will that KPI inspire the most meaningful change? I mean, we can measure a lot of the things, but what's the point if we can't do the change based on that? Is it possible to track the KPI in a meaningful way? Because remember that it requires the maintenance. Each KPI, each measurement requires the maintenance. So it's going to require some resource who's tracking that. And that leads to the question, how much extra work will be created by tracking that KPI? The first thing what you need to do is when you start to do your first KPIs, you just take these questions and you make the initial round of the KPI brainstorming, and it will likely result with the huge list of the potential KPIs. Like, let's measure amount of the box. Let's measure the speed of a CI/CD pipeline. Let's measure, I don't know, the top five and so on. But you need to do the several rounds. Ask and ask again and cut those which don't fit with these questions. Slightly like removing piece by piece. And then you should end up with, I would say, with the limited like 5 or 6 KPIs, which you will be capable to measure and maintain in terms of your team. Okay, it was a bit theoretical, but let's look on the particular examples. I will give you the examples, what I have seen so far as a most common ones. And the first one is the number of the security findings identified in the code. So think about this as a number of the security defects identified pre-production, like the number of the bugs, what you have identified, and you have divided this by the code base of an application. So it helps to set the goals and measure the progress within the team and with like the specific application or the service. Let's take the example. At the beginning on the pre-production, when you started, you notice that you have like 5 or 6 security related bugs per, 1,000 line of the code. And then when time passes, you can see that either that number increases or it decreases. And another thing is the security findings burn rate. And in this case, like you just look like how quickly those defects are addressed by the team. One thing, like, you know, you done the finding, you added that this needs to be fixed, placed in the backlog, and you forgot it. Like, time goes by. There's no point like that you have identified that security bug if it was not fixed. So you need to measure that time between the finding and when it was usually fixed. And then there are the two security KPIs, really useful ones, like the top vulnerability types and the top recurring bugs. So that helps to the security teams or your security ambassador or security dedicated person in the team to track the top vulnerability types. So they can, they will be in a much more better position to help the developers make long-term improvements, like in the way of their code. Let's take the example. If I see that you constantly fail with input validation, instead of the writing the useless long how-to manuals, how to implement or how to scan the dependencies, me as a security person, I would spend my time, since my time is also limited, I would spend the time to address these top ones, or like this, in this particular case, input sanitization, and I will create the short video or the short the small library for the development team. Another thing is like the percentage of the code coverage from the security testing. That's an obviously the same goes like when you do the unit test, you're measuring how well your code is covered in terms of the unit test. So maybe it's worth to think that you would like also to measure if you are implementing some security tests in your automated test, and then you can just like, you know, to measure the percentage. The next one is really important one, especially at the beginning and progressing over the time, is that the number of failed builds due to the security checks. And that's obviously that number is going to be quite high at the beginning of implementing each security action, which I was showing you before. And the last one is the metrics and events from the production security controls. So let's take the example. You have the web application firewall in the front of your application. And this is where you can grab and measure the events. So you can later to compare with the number of the defects identified pre-production and identified the post-production. So you can see at least the range, how it goes with the security improvement. So I want to show you the few common examples, what I have seen as implemented, especially when the teams start to address their measurements, like how effective they are in the security. And let's look from the practical side. Remember, I showed you the whole DevSecOps practices, like the tools and the processes, what you can implement in development life. Most probably you have some of them. You don't have all of them, obviously. And it's going to take a lot of the resources and the time to implement. But if you have some of them, and I would like to show the most common one, I guess you may have in the place, like usually the teams or the companies with whom I worked and I'm working, they usually start and have a quite good posture when it comes to dependency management by using the different tools from SNCC, WhiteSource, and you name it. Then the static code analysis tools. And then maybe some of the companies have the security scanning and of course the pen test. So you have all of these things in the place and they kind of the work. And again, then the question is like, how do we know that all of these practices are efficient? At the time when you start to implement a new security solution, you need immediately think about how you're going to measure the progress. Because if you will learn to speak in the KPI language, you will have also the strongest arguments to operate with your stakeholders for the asking money for other not implemented security tools. So let's look how we can implement the measurement. So how should I go and measure? Again, most probably you notice it, I'm not the strong supporter of just jumping and buying like the solution. Therefore, for this specific talk, I'm keeping out the commercial solutions. There are on the market a lot of the good and good solutions, which helps you to build all these KPI metrics, security related or the DevOps. But as for today, the commercial solutions are out of the scope because, like I mentioned, most of them are still vendor-based. They can't measure your particular security controls what you have implemented on the top. They usually can measure only the controls what they have provided to you. And then the second advice what I would say is in the nature I'm tend to be when it comes to the security, I tend to be quite cheap person. I try to look what I have in the house, how I can use the things what I already have implemented and maybe to tune it up or write something more on the top before I go and buy something. And then let's take the one scenario. I do have the Azure DevOps here with all my Azure pipelines. So what I'm doing right now, I'm keeping all my code in Azure repository. I'm tracking all my work items and all my Scrum process everything I'm tracking in the board. And I'm doing some development for the, depends on what Git branching strategy you have. It's just simple like with the development. And I'm building some application like Java or this .NET application, which later I compile and pack it as a container, pushing that to the container registry, and then pushing to the one of the stages like in the cloud. And of course, on the time being, then I got interested in the security. I have implemented some security tools on top of that ecosystem. And in this particular case, I'm like doing, for example, I start to use the check marks for the SAST, like the static application security testing, just to check that all my code is fine. Then I'm using the White Source Bolt extension to the my CI/CD pipeline, which allows me to see the statistics around my packages and the licensing, and gives me the reports like in CSV format and so on. And then I'm using, in this case, like the OWASP app for the scanning of my application and producing the results. If I do have some top 10 vulnerabilities, the top 10, OWASP top 10 vulnerabilities in my application. And I'm using one or another solution for the container scanning. Here I just placed Anchor, but it may be like AquaSec and you name it. And some of the security tools also provided by the Microsoft. So I can get the different reports in the different places from all of these tools. Usually you end up either to have these reports in unit testing or as a separate format as CSV. But the good thing is a lot of these solutions, they also like Anchor or the checkmarks whatsoever, they do provide the APIs, right? So you can connect directly and request that report to collect it. So what you can do, you can think and like spend maybe like a few days or the week or two and build the simple Azure functions with the aim to collect all of these reports. Like I can build the Azure functions, which just makes the API calls to the Azure DevOps and grabs the statistics from the repository in terms of the amount of the code and what type of the code and so on. Then I can do the API calls to all of these set of the security tools, or I can just grab CSV files and process them and process all of them via Azure functions and then to put the results in the some way of the storage. Do the some processing and publish the result simply to the Power BI, which is going to be available for the users. That's kind of the simple solution, what you can build on the top of the existing environment and the existing ecosystem, what you already have in the place. It's going to cost you some money, like in time-wise and in the cloud, cloud-wise, but it's still less than comparing just to buying the vendor solution, right? And if you look on the some practical side, as you can see, like in the Power BI, I do have some examples published from the tools like the White Source Bolt, where I have seen all my dependencies. And also I grabbed some work items which are marked like as a bug or has a tag as a security, as a statistic. So I can grab and count the total vulnerabilities among total security related work items and track it from the Azure board at the burn rate and so on. And at the same, like I mentioned, this is the example of the dependency check and OWASP upscan, what I have implemented inside of the my CI/CD pipeline, and also publishing these results in the build pipeline in the same place as an unit test. But what I do, I also collect that information to show it later into the Power BI. So if you spend some time and build this type of the This type of the solution, it can give you a real good the good start in terms of the measuring the security. So let me look on the some final thoughts what I want to address. And like I said, I gave you the some examples, but there will never be a set of the correct KPIs to measure, because again, it really depends on what is in the place right now in your team. Maybe you just started with the dependency management, right? Maybe you just have that one simple tool. So other security KPIs, like measuring some other security things like from dependencies and so, these KPIs are not relevant for you. You can start only with the identified findings in terms of the packages, how fast or how long it took to fix them, and so on. The key to choose the KPI is to ensure that they are smart. So by this I mean you need to get back to that abbreviation, and when you start to choose which KPIs you would like to use, just go through the round of that SMART and see if it's measurable, if it's actionable, if it's reasonable, and then so on. I would say limit yourself if you have several security tools. I would say limit with the 5 or the 6 common metrics to start with, because the problem is the more KPIs you have, the more maintenance should be done. And this is where we get with the same trap what I have seen with the implementing the metrics for the DevOps. It's the more metrics you have, the more time is going to the maintenance. And the question is, who's going to take that maintenance? And that's another thing. When you define the KPIs, at the same time, you need to define who is going to own those KPIs. Is it your security team? Or is it going to be the security ambassador inside of your team or dedicated person? Because it's going to take the time. You need constantly to look that these KPIs are still relevant, that you get the results, and most important, that person also at some point should have the rights to enforce you to do the actions for the improving these KPIs. If you see that it takes quite a long time to implement to fix the finding, then that person should somehow to trigger and help to fix that time. So, each KPI you define must have an owner. And the last is build reporting on the top of use technologies. That's a good beginning. That's a really good beginning, because it's all about the same practices when we speak about the tools. It's quite easy to buy the tool, to implement it, and then get disappointed because you realize that maybe it doesn't fit to your needs. It requires a lot of maintenance. And at the end of the day, you're just switching it off. So maybe it's worth to build the reporting on the things what you already have in the place, and get that habit first, that you are really measuring your security posture and you are following up. So the few points for the call for the action. First of all, define what DevSecOps means to your organization. In the same way how you did with the DevOps, you need to define what is DevSecOps, particularly for your organization. Then you identify your DevSecOps challenges, because this helps you to limit the scope, and it helps you to prioritize which list of the KPIs should be addressed, so what you want to measure. And then you have identified that list of the KPIs. Just run it through the SMART cycle several times to be sure that they are quite good enough. And again, don't try with a lot of the KPIs. Start with Like if you have one or two security tools in the place, maybe it's enough to have the three, four even metrics, but try to limit with the five or the six metrics. And last but not least, like the leverage already used solutions like to build the collecting and the reporting. That's, I guess, is the most common advice. Before we go for the shopping, we always check what we have in the fridge, right? So not to buy something more what we don't need. And remember that without the appropriate measurement, the DevSecOps is just a hype, right? We can say we do the DevSecOps, but how do you know that you are doing that? It's just like, because we do have DevSecOps. Yeah, I guess I'm going to wrap up and I have 10 minutes for the questions. And thanks for the staying with me online. And let me let's ask the questions. If you are shy or you don't have the questions right now, these are my contacts and just ping me and I will be happy to help. Otherwise, I would say have a great day and enjoy the conference. Sure. Okay. Then I guess
I was just going to jump in and say thank you very much for presenting. Thank you to everybody for tuning in. As you might be able to see, I'm currently sat watching you outside in my garden in the sunshine, which is something that you don't get to do at real conferences. But yeah, thank you. That was a really, really awesome session. Really enjoyed it. We will have the Slack channels and workspaces open throughout, and we're inviting speakers to drop in. So if you do suddenly think of a really good question later this afternoon, drop that in there. But in the meantime, thank you, Victoria, for speaking. We really appreciate it. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in, switching your cameras on, giving us some eye contact and some smiles so it doesn't feel quite so weird.
Yeah. Thank you, Dylan.
And if there's no questions. Awesome.
Awesome. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.